This telescope is attached to an equatorial mount. This telescope is also attached to an equatorial mount. And in this video, I'm going to use this telescope and a globe to show you how to properly set up and use this full-size equatorial mount. And later on in this video, I'll demonstrate the number one advantage of using an equatorial mount. For a long time, equatorial mounts have had a bad reputation as a hobby killer. Are they really that way? Well, hopefully at the end of this video, you might see things a little bit differently.
Was it ever really fair to call this style of telescope mount a hobby killer? Well, admittedly, these aren't the easiest of mounts to set up, so for a lot of new telescope owners, it did cast a shadow on their first telescope experience. But thanks to the internet and YouTube, equatorial mounts no longer need to be the stumbling block between users and their new telescope. No matter what telescope you have, it only takes two movements to point it at your desired target in the sky. Now, as you can imagine, there are a few ways to combine these movements. In this simple example, we swing it to the left, to the right, and then we tilt it up until we have our target in sight. That side-to-side angle is called azimuth. It's measured from true north. This up and down angle is called altitude, where 0 degrees is horizontal and 90 degrees is vertical. For these simple telescope mounts, we call them alt-azimuth, or alt-az for short. Now, my favorite alt-az style of mount is the Dobsonian, as shown here. I sometimes call these the point-and-go telescopes. These alt-az telescopes have an inherent weakness, though. As the night sky spins, you have to keep moving your telescope in both angles to keep up. Also, the view itself does not rotate with the movement, which causes problems for long-exposure astrophotography. And if you try to track a target across the absolute roof of the sky, or the zenith, then you quickly find out how hard that can be. This region of the sky is sometimes jokingly referred to as Dobson's Hole.
There is another type of mount system, and it's called the equatorial mount. It uses two angles as well, but they have very different names. The first is called the right ascension, and the right ascension angle is actually measured in hours. It goes from 0 all the way up to basically 24. You can see here where the point where it cycles over. The other angle or axis that you have is the declination angle, and it goes from basically minus 90 to 0 to plus 90, and it gives you the angle measured between the equatorial plane and the celestial poles. Now, I'm only telling you about these alternate angle systems to let you know that the system exists in the world of equatorial mounts, but for the rest of this video, we're going to focus on the physical side of setting up and using an equatorial mount. This is the last time you'll hear me talk about right ascension and declination angles. The main advantage of the equatorial mount is that once you have it set up, you can track your target with the adjustment of one single knob. And that only works because your equatorial axis is lined up or parallel with the Earth's axis. Here is my simple six-step formula for setting up any equatorial mount. I'm going to do most of this demonstration during the day so you can see what I'm doing, but in reality, you're going to have to do some of this at night because, as you'll soon see, it's all about the North Star. So the first step is to locate your equatorial mount in a location that has a pretty good view of the North Star. In my case, it's between that tree and that roof. Now, the North Star is the last star in the handle of the Little Dipper. That should help you find it. And it's very unique. It would seem that the entire sky is actually rotating around the North Star. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. Now, once you have your location picked, do your best to aim this main polar axis to true north. Ideally, you would use the North Star as a guide, but you can also use a compass. You just have to know that true north is a little bit different from magnetic north. In fact, it can be quite a bit different depending on where you live. Step three is to level the mount, basically the top of the tripod part. Now, you can use a bubble level to do that, and that's what I'm going to do here. So here we see the bubble level. It needs to tilt up this way. So I'll unloosen this leg and lift it up. That's pretty good. I'm going to tighten the leg. It needs to come a little bit the other way. So. There we go. And just a little bit of tweaking here. And we're good. Step 4 is polar alignment, what I like to call, what's your latitude? All right, this is the big one. Equatorial mounts take advantage of the fact that all objects seem to rise in the east and set in the west, effectively spinning around the North Star. Now, for our intents and purposes, we're going to consider the North Star to be pretty constant. It does move a little bit, but we're going to assume that it is a constant in the night sky. The North Star goes by several different names. It goes by Polaris, and it goes by the Pole Star. That's a lot of names, but you may see it written different ways in different books. Now, for those of you that live in the southern hemisphere, there is a southern pole star called Polaris Australis. Unfortunately, it's pretty dim, but if you can see it, if you can find it, then you can use that star to align your polar axis. Okay, so we have to point the polar axis of the equatorial mount at the North Star. And this all works because of a cosmic coincidence that has enabled navigators for hundreds of years, if not longer, to determine their latitude. And it's all based on a very weird bit of geometry. Here we have the Earth, and it's spinning about its own axis. Now, I know the real one's tilted a little bit, but I've straightened it up just for this explanation. Now, if you were to take the axis and you were to extend it out the top of the planet and keep going and keep going and keep going for about 434 light years, well, then you would end up near a star called Polaris. It's not exactly on the axis, of course, but it's close enough for our purposes. And at that far distance, some very funny math happens. So the Earth's radius is around 4,000 miles. Let's draw a little section of the Earth. So here's the core. This is, let's say this is the equator up here. And this is the North Pole. So I've got it tilted on its side. Okay. So the radius from the center, let's say the radius is around 4,000 miles. Roughly. Okay, now let's draw a line from the core out the axis to a temporary spot out here. I'm going to connect these. These are all just rough. You'll notice that basically this is a big right triangle here, 90 degrees. Now, if I were to grab this point right here on the triangle and start pulling and pulling and pulling and keep dragging this distance until I got to Polaris, I'd be about 2,500 trillion miles away. And at that distance, something funny happens here locally to the geometry. And that is that the legs of these triangles become functionally parallel. All right. It's so, the Polaris is so far that way that these two lines are effectively parallel. So what does this mean to an observer on Earth? This means that no matter where you're standing, at least in the northern hemisphere, if you point in the what you perceive as the north direction of the North Star, your arm will be pointing parallel to the Earth's axis. Let's say you're about halfway up the Earth, and you do the same thing. You point towards the North Star. Well, you're pointing parallel to the Earth's axis. And again, once you get to the North Pole, it probably goes without saying, but I'll say it. If you point your arm towards the North Star, you're pointing parallel to the Earth's axis. Because of this, the measured angle between your local horizon and the North Star is simply going to be your latitude. Sailors have long measured this angle with a tool called a sextant. And it's been very popular for navigators, even some aerial navigators in the early days of aviation used a sextant if they could get a stable measurement of the horizon and the North Star from their airplane. Now, let's have an example here. Let's say you are trying to find the North Star and you're somewhere on the equator, okay? So you're standing at the equator and you try to find the North Star. You look for the last star in the handle of the Little Dipper. And you find it, and you discover that it's basically on the horizon. It's set about 0 degrees above the horizon. Well, that works out, doesn't it? Because your telescope is parallel with the Earth's axis, and that means if you're standing right here, then it's going to look like it's right on the horizon. Now, as the traveler takes a long trip and goes all the way up the Earth and heads up towards the top, he has to keep tilting his telescope higher and higher
And by the time he gets to the true North Pole, where the axis exits the Earth, his telescope is pointing straight up from the ground. And that means his latitude is around 90 degrees. Now, of course, if we go about, let's say down here, let's say we're at the region called Texas, and we're in Texas, and you want to point your telescope at the North Star, you're going to have an angle with the relative ground, with the horizon, that's about, say, 30 degrees, I would say. Now, I have a confession to make. I looked this up on Google Maps, and it's actually around 32-ish degrees. And if you look at this, this angle is pretty similar to the one that I have when I set it up out in the driveway. So the first step for polar alignment is to just know your latitude.
One of the easiest ways to find your latitude is to open up Google Maps. So go to your web browser and type in maps.google.com and zoom in and keep zooming until you get to a location that is close to basically where you're at. And then right click the mouse button and a little menu pops up. And the two numbers at the top are the latitude and the longitude. And it's the number on the left, the latitude, that we are interested in.
With the tripod leveled and everything pointed generally in the north direction, we know our latitude. In our case, it's about between 32 and 33 degrees. We're going to look here on the latitude dial, and we're going to make sure that this white arrow points as close as we can to 32 degrees. In this case, it looks like it's pointed around 38. So I'm going to turn this knob until it gets to around 32. And then we'll go a little bit, well, between 32 and 34. That's pretty good. A lot of equatorial mounts have the special feature, so we'll remove the cap down there. This allows you to look straight through the polar axis towards the North Star. And we will make sure that the North Star is basically right in the middle. This is a great time, if you have a polar scope, to use it.
A polar scope is like a little telescope that has a transparency overlaid on it that shows you the location of Polaris and some of the other pertinent items that will help you make it perfectly aligned. Here's what you see when you look through a true polar scope. In the middle is the plus sign, and that shows the true central axis. Note that Polaris, or the North Star, is actually a little bit off. In fact, the path that it traces is a little circle that goes tightly around the true central axis, the true center of the spinning sky. There's a couple of little helper graphics here that tell you how to orient this. You basically line it up on Polaris. Polaris will actually be shining through this view, and you'll want to get it so that the Big Dipper is off in the general direction that it says, and also that Cassiopeia is off in the general direction. So this polar scope helps you get really zeroed in on perfect true north.
If you need to go left or right, there's a couple of screws on the front. This guy and this guy, they are opposing each other, but they will lock down. So use those to move the whole head left and right to get perfect polar alignment on the North Star. Step five is to attach the telescope to your equatorial mount and then balance it. So let's go ahead and attach it. You can certainly do this ahead of time, but it's sometimes very heavy to do so. This telescope has an old mount system. Yours may have a newer ring system or Vixen dovetail, which is pretty nice. So let's go ahead and attach this. There we go, all done. Now you need to balance it for your particular telescope. Go ahead and loosen up the lock on the polar axis. This way, it can rotate. And you want to adjust this weight back and forth. Be very careful though, it can flop around. You want to adjust this weight to make sure it's perfectly balanced. So that's not balanced. You want it to be neutrally balanced, technically. So adjust this weight until it pretty much stays where you put it. Let's try it. That's pretty good. We'll call this balanced. Now, at this point, all you have to do is point your telescope at your target. It can seem a little bit awkward with all these movements, and if you unlock everything, it can be spinning everywhere, right? A little bit awkward. But there's really only two primary axes that you're worried about, and they each have a lock nut on them. But once you get it dialed in on your target, you lock these down, then you make very fine movements with these flexible knobs, all right? Now, if you get everything polar aligned, which I know you have already, then you only need to move this knob, which is the one that moves it along the polar axis. I believe that's called the right ascension axis. Now, there's often two different ways to look at the same target. And this is where it gets a little bit weird with the equatorial mount. You can point it like this, or you can rotate it around, and you can point it like this. Both ways are pointed towards the same target. Just pick the one that is most convenient for you, especially for your eyepiece. You might have to do some rotating on your eyepiece holder. But also another thing to keep in mind is which one is going to run out of room first, because if this one goes too far, it's going to run into its own mount. So you might want to start all the way over here, and then as the night goes on, you'll have a lot more play because you'll have this whole amount of free rotation. Pick the one that won't run out of movement as soon. Then lock these in, and again, you only have to turn the polar axis or the right ascension knob. One thing to be very careful about is the eyepiece. Make sure the eyepiece is locked in. And if you happen to do a big rotation, be very careful, because there's a chance that you may get to an orientation where the eyepiece falls out. Don't let that happen. You don't want to destroy an eyepiece just because you were trying to move the telescope around. Now, just to summarize that main single advantage of the equatorial mount, and that is that when you have everything lined up, you can track your object in the sky just by turning this knob slowly. Now, there are ways to motorize this axis as well to make it automatic, and that works pretty well too. But again, if you're having a star party and people are saying, hey, it moved out of the view, well, you just turn this knob a little bit and it's going to pop back into view. This makes life a lot easier. So there you go. Enjoy your new equatorial mount. It's no longer the hobby killer that it used to be. Be sure to like and subscribe. Clear skies, everybody.